Let's have a look here. So. If you have all these four layers here, what we did, we were setting the computational region to match all these four layers. You can test this by zooming to the computational region with this option here, zoom to computational region. Or in GRASS 7, there's a separate button to zoom to there. In any case, you should see something like this. You should see exactly the same. Who is not seeing this, apart from you two? You got this? Okay. What we now do here, we have four tiles, and now we want to patch them together. For this, we use the command r.patch, which is located under raster, overlay rasters, patch raster maps. Okay. You get the standard GRASS-like dialogue. In my case, there's already one, the selected map added. Here we can add multiple maps to the input. We want to patch all these together. So I have to specify all of them. And as output, I use a new name, SRTM underscore V2, to indicate that this is version 2 SRTM data. Okay. Then click on Run. Because I have done that before, I have to allow overwriting. This will take a few seconds, and then we have it. I move this one to the bottom. Did you get this result? Okay. Then deactivate the tiles, and the image here, just to be safe, reload, should not have changed. You should still see the same. But you need to deactivate these tiles. They should no longer be displayed. Okay? Cool. The patch combines all these four tiles into one new raster map. Above each other. To illustrate this again, this is the first tile, yes. So this is only sitting here. The other tiles are sitting here and here and here. And they simply patch it all together, filling the no data. In theory, the order of the patching matters if they would lie right on top of each other, but here they lie next to each other, and therefore the order doesn't match. Okay.
If they overlap?
Yeah, if they are right on top of each other, then the order would match. then it would take would look at the first map. If there's a valid pixel, it takes this one. If in the first map the pixel is no data, it looks at the second map. If there's a valid pixel, it takes that one, and so on. So it looks at the first map, and then the second, and then the third, and then the fourth. And as soon as it finds a valid pixel that is not no data, it uses this one and then continues on with the next pixel. Okay. On the command line, I have done a few little tricks. There's a command called gmlist, where you can list all types of spatial data that are available in your current in your GRASS session. Here I specify type equal rust, and I defined a pattern with wildcards. So if you look at the tiles here, they all start with capital N, then comes the degrees of the corner, then there comes a capital E, and then come the degrees of the corner. So in order to list all the tiles that somehow conform to this pattern, I can use this command. Then I see it will list all raster maps that conform to this wildcard pattern. I can construct a list. Now every tile, every raster map is sitting in a separate line. I can also put them all together by specifying the separator, which would be here, comma. And then it looks like this. So the tiles are again listed, but the tile names are separated by comma and not a new line. Okay, now comes the next little trick. This is working on the command line only. I can use this list here as input for r.patch. What we just used r.patch to patch all these four tiles together. And I can also use this command to achieve exactly the same. This is for people who like the command line and don't like to click so many times. The result is exactly the same. This is useful if you want to do more stuff with this list. Actually, this list here, or these four tiles, have been previously used to define the new computational region. So I can use exactly the same stuff here to define the computational region. This is advanced stuff. If anybody's interested, I'm available on Friday for further questions. But this makes batch processing of stuff really fast on the command line. You set up a little script to process any number of tiles, and then it quickly runs through, and you don't have to click that much. You set up your script, hit enter, have a coffee break, come back, and the results are there. That's the idea. Okay. We have patched this stuff together. Now, let's first have a look at Jesus. Okay. Now I'm activating any of the original tiles, and I want to have a look at the metadata. metadata is right click again, the context menu and the bottom entry. And what I'm interested here in is those of you familiar with the original SRTM data know that they do not start exactly at 1 degree, but they are shifted by half a pixel. So there's always a little overlap. That means north is not exactly at 60 degree, but at 60 degree plus 1.5 arc seconds. The resolution of the SRTM data is 3 arc seconds. Okay. Now we import the CGIR SRTM DEM in the data that you downloaded from the website. There's a GeoTIFF file called SRTM underscore CGIRTIFF. This here. And that one you can import with the standard import tool, like import common formats, import raster data, common formats import. Okay? You get the dialogue that you hopefully remember. And I have it here. I don't. For those of you using Windows and GRASS 7, you can set the current working directory to your data directory. Then you save a lot of clicks. You don't always have to browse to there. Okay. I open this thing here. That looks all fine to me. And I can proceed to import these data. Okay. You two over there, you can import the TIFF that I gave to you exactly the same like this, and after that import this one in the same manner. Import, done, close. Okay, let's have a look. Are you there? I activate, display this layer, and you can see here it looks vastly different. So the first thing that we do is we set a color table. We set again the SRTM color table. This can again be done right mouse click on the newly imported raster data, set color table. Here it's called colors. On GRASS 7 it's called define. Type of color table would be SRTM, run, close. In this data set, ocean has been completely masked out, as you can see here. So ocean is no data, white. Only there is a little bit of ocean that is not connected in the DEM, not connected to the real ocean. In reality, there is most probably a tiny little channel connecting it to the ocean. That's why this is there. Okay. Do you all have this display? Ah, okay. But you are using GRASS 7. Okay, yes. I forgot that I have built in this functionality in GRASS 7. So, because this TIFF that you just imported, I created with GRASS, exported it to GeoTIFF, and the color rules are embedded in the metadata And in grass 7, during import, these color rules are again applied from the metadata. So this is why you didn't have to apply the color rules. Where are we? Okay, we have imported this dem. Some quick specifications about the NASA SRTM. The 90% errors in meters for Eurasia, as in the official publication for SRTM data, are for the absolute geolocation 8.8 meters. This is quite amazing considering that we are working with a 90 meter resolution dem. So they say that they have an absolute geolocation error of only less than 9 meters. This is quite accurate, I would say. The absolute height error is in the 90% interval is 6 meters, and the relative height error is 9 meters for the NASA SRTM version 2 data. Okay, when we now have a look at the metadata of this SRTM CGIR TIFF raster data, so right click, go on metadata, you now see that we don't have this 1.5 second shift. Instead, it's the pixels are aligned exactly on the degree border. That means compared to the original SRTM data, we have a shift of half a pixel. Half a pixel means roughly 45 meter. Yeah? So 3 arc seconds is roughly 90 meter. Half a pixel is roughly 45 meter. So this CGIR grid is shifted by round about 45 meter against the original SRTM data. But the accuracy of the SRTM data in geolocation is 9 meter. But now we have shifted it. We experience a shift of 45 meter. This is not so nice because, well, now the CGIR data, they are introducing an error, a geolocation error, which is now actually 45 meter plus 9 meter. So, not so nice. We can also have a look at the simply at the range of the data. So this goes here from minus 20 meter to 1624 for this area. And we can also have a look at the SRTM data. And here it looks pretty similar. So this is promising, there's no big difference in the height. Yeah? Just looking at the range. Good question. But this, there is probably somewhere a depression. There can be areas below sea level. This is not uncommon. I'm not familiar with this part of Norway, so I don't know if this is actually realistic that somewhere we have something below sea level. I know that in Netherlands, for example, there are quite a few areas below sea level. And minus 20 is quite a bit, but there are many areas on Earth, at least, that are below sea level, minus 20 or even more. So consider the Death Valley in the United States. I think this is below sea level. Definitely the Dead Sea in Israel and many other places. Actually, later on, I will show an example where we are going to minus 30 below sea level. This is the Caspian Sea, which is also slowly disappearing, drying up. and the sea level, the surface level of the Caspian Sea is already way below absolute sea level.
Can we make a mask, for example, to show those which are below the sea level?
Yes, this is relatively easy. I deactivate this one. I only display now the SRTM version 2. Then I go on properties. I can go on selection and say I want to see everything from minus 21 to minus 20. Apply. Oha. Ah, sorry. This now I have displayed everything from minus 21 to 20. I need to add another minus 20 here. I guess this is only one or two pixels, which I cannot see here. We can try that. No, I must at least go to minus 1. I guess it's only there are a few spots. Yes. Yeah.
So there are depressions in the sea.
Now this looks like fjords. Oh, says who? Okay, so this is not unrealistic according to this information.
I mean, it's not a crude site or something.
Okay, let's assume this could be possible. Yeah, could be. What I want to do here is I want to compare these two SRTM versions once more. So what we do now is we go on settings, region, we set the computational region, and now we set the resolution. Remember, the two grids, this version 2 and this CGIR dem, they are shifted against each other by half a pixel. So in order to catch the differences, we have to change the resolution from 3 arc seconds to 1.5 arc seconds. If you have this dialog, the G region dialog, you go onto resolution, then 2D grid resolution, and you type in GRASS the conventional format for degrees, minutes, seconds is to separate them by colon. So 0 degrees, 0 minutes, and then 0.5 arc seconds. This we use as the new resolution for the computational region. Okay? And let's print the region. So this is still something one can work with. We are now at 32 million grid cells, not too much. Now we calculate a difference map. Is everybody there and has this the same region settings? These are important now for the difference map. Yes? No? Okay. One moment. Ah, hier, ja. Like this. Okay, and you have this. Where is it? You have this output?
I don't have detail output.
You don't have?
The details. I have a successful output, but again, I don't have.
Okay, go on the print tab and activate this.
Yeah.
And now you should have some output. Okay, now we go on to raster. We use the raster map calculator again. Get this funky interface. Okay. I define a new output map, which I call now SRTM div. I load the version 2 SRTM. Minus load the CGIR DEM. Okay. Yes, this was in order to enforce floating point, because the Landsat bands were integer, and so the Landsat bands, the numbers, the digital numbers are simply integers from 0 to 255. But in order to enforce floating point, I used this 1.0. Because a normalized difference vegetation index ranges from minus 1 to 1. Here we don't need this, we simply want the difference between these two maps. And the output data type, it can be integer or floating point, will be inherited from these input data. So, run. Finished. Okay. Now I want to see the difference map. The difference map now looks, the coloring is useless for diagnostics. So I set the color table again, set color table for the SRTM difference map. Okay. And now I want to use a coloring scheme that's called differences. In Grass 7, you get a little preview for these different color tables, and you can also look at the manual. There is everything explained, what all this stuff is good for what data they are appropriate. Okay, run. And what do I see? Not a lot. Yes. Okay, what is everybody there? We can now interactively where is this? In GRASS 7, this is called Manage Colors Interactively, the menu entry. In GRASS 6, I have to guess. Yeah. So those of you using GRASS 6, they need to use this color rules entry. Those of you using GRASS 7, are you on GRASS 7? Yes. Exactly, yeah. You should get something that looks like this. Yes, okay. So I want to modify this color table. Let me have a quick look at the specs. So we have an absolute or relative height error of less than 10 meter, yeah, according to the specifications. So I say I want to have everything from the minimum of the differences here is minus 774 meter. This is quite a huge difference between the two dams. And the maximum difference is nearly 500 meter. This is also really a lot considering the specifications. I add a new rule here, or I modify this rule. I say minus 10, let's say minus 20. Otherwise, it gets a little bit too heavy. And I set this to blue again. Okay. I modify this one here. 500. Zero. Make this white. Twenty. Make this red. This NV was no data, or the default for, but we don't need this. And the default value for anything else is white here, but we also don't need this. So here I give 500 and make it red again. And you should have the same. That means everything. All differences that are minus 20 or lower will become blue. From minus 20 to 0, there will be a gradient from blue to white. From 0 to 20, there will be a gradient from white to red. And everything above 20 will be red. Okay, I want to see a preview. Oha. I already see quite a bit. I'm happy with that, so I click on apply. I leave this open here. And now I want to zoom in a little bit to show something. This funny pattern here remember that we calculated the difference map with double the resolution. What we see here is an effect of the grid shift. So, like every second pixel has a very low difference, and every other second pixel has a very high difference. This is because of the pixel shift against each other of the two original dams. Now we could try to figure out how to shift one of the grids against the others to get a better match, but this is not really the purpose, or it would be quite a bit of work. But here, this kind of pixel shift is already apparent. another diagnostic now is, even though the ranges of the data of the two dams looked okay, looked similar, the difference map shows quite huge differences, as we have seen already. The difference goes from minus 700 meters to plus 500 meters. This is also quite a lot, considering that the specification of the difference is below 10 meters accuracy. Yes?
Is it possible to create a histogram? Because we now have very large
losses. Yes. You can compare the histogram, but I guess the histogram again will show fairly similar values. It's really more interesting to compare each pixel, also do pixel by pixel comparison. You can, in GRASS 7, which you are using, I guess, GRASS 7, yeah. There's a histogram thingy. Yeah, yeah. Okay, I would stop this diagnostic here, so you can go on looking at the histogram of the difference map. You can also look at the histogram of the original dams to see if something changed there. You can try to shift one of those, to shift the CGIR dam back to match the original SRTM dam, and so on. So, yeah. But this, I do not want to do here. Instead, I want to continue with the next exercise. This was more to illustrate quickly what you can do with just looking at the metadata, at the range of the values, and using the computational region to set the resolution to half the original resolution and then calculate this difference map. So I hope the computational region, not only as a setting but also as a tool, has been demonstrated now. So far, okay? Cool. Then let's close this GRASS session and continue with the last exercise. Or are there still any questions? Okay. I don't want to store all that stuff. Okay. Okay, as I start GRASS anew, and you should get this welcome screen again. Is everybody there? Well, this is the location that we just created to work with the dams. If you start grass again, you should have exactly the same like before, whatever you called it. No, you don't. Yeah, that looks.
It's different.
It's different. Where is the grass database that you just created before? I don't know where you created your grass database.
No, it's in within grass data. I created geostat and it's in there.
Ah, okay. So you must go to there. Go in there. Yes. Okay.
So I say okay.
Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. So you all have this screen here. We are now creating a new map set, which I call Caspian, because the next example is on the Caspian Sea, which is located below sea level. So for me, this looks like this now. Caspian is already pre-selected. Is everybody there? Who is not there? Okay. Enter. Again, we import raster data, common import formats. Only one raster map now. Again, a geotiff. And now I want to have this as this Caspian Sea. Geotiff. So for my personal taste, this name is a little bit too long. So I delete parts of that. This is up to you how you name it, so it doesn't matter. Okay. Run or import the data. Oh no. Right now I see nothing, so I try to zoom to the selected map and I see the standard rainbow coloring. Now, okay, yes. For those of you that are still using GRASS 6, they have to set the color table to SRTM. Am I the only one using Grass 6? No. One. Two. The. One. Okay. Now we see something like this. Yes? Okay. So, this is the global multi-resolution digital elevation model. In this case, it's the 30-second resolution dam. And this has been created from the original Landsat tiles. Landsat tiles, original SRTM tiles, sorry. SRTM tiles are only available for land areas. So at least one pixel must be on land. This is the Caspian Sea, and the Caspian Sea is regarded as water body. And this is a fairly large water body, and quite a few SRTM tiles have been not produced because they are completely within the Caspian Sea. You will find similar effects like missing tiles for the Great Lakes in North America and in other places on the world. I choose this example because it's particularly complicated and because it's located below sea level. So what happened here is, if there is no SRTM tile available, they replaced it with zero. So they assumed we are at 0 meters above sea level, which in this case is not correct. So, question is, how do we get from here to there? How do we fix this? Any idea? I'm not asking about what grass modules to use, I'm just asking about the general procedure. How would you fix these artifacts to get a reasonable looking them? No, we are only using these data. Look at the edges?
Yes, of the existing cars.
Yeah.
Those heights.
Yeah.
In a clever way.
Yes. This is the correct answer. Any other suggestions? Okay. Possible, yeah. Okay, the first question is, how do we identify this funny thingy here? How can we... You can regard all these missing tiles, they are adjacent to each other. So you can regard this as a clump of raster data that all have the same value. Yeah? How, so can we identify this patch here somehow? Yes. Yeah, but we cannot just use anything that has zero values, because we have zero values here, and here, and all around here. So this is the Caspian Sea, which is slowly drying out. It's below sea level, but the shores are exactly at sea level. To demonstrate, I can select to display only grid cells at zero value. And as you can see, there are quite a lot. So we have this big patch here, and the shore, and something going a little bit inside. Okay. Sorry? So what I suggest is, identify the elevation of the artifact We already established that this is at 0 meters. There's a little tool in the map display here, query raster or vector maps. If you activate this tool and then click on the map, you get output here, which gives you the coordinates and the raster value, which is in this case 0. What I'm doing now is I zoom in a lot. Upsala. I need the zoom tool. And I want to know the elevation of the next valid grid cell. So I click here and I get minus 27 meters, so 27 meters below sea level. I will check this again by...
But you cannot see how large your grid cells are.
No, this doesn't matter. I will have a look now in, by the way, by means of displaying only grid cells of minus 27 meter. I zoom to the full extent, and at first glance this looks quite promising. So the artifact is completely enclosed by minus 27 meter. Elevation. We can assume that, well, there is still water, it's still a lake, and the surface of the lake should be at constant elevation relative to sea level, as long as there's not a heavy storm going on. So this looks reasonable. Go back to here. What I suggest is, well, identify the elevation of the artifact. This was 0 meter. Everything was set to the missing tiles were replaced with the 0. Figure out the correct elevation. This is 27 meter. Now we can create clumps, or what you call clusters. That is, we identify each patch of 0 meter and give this a unique ID. Then we get the ID of the clump with the artifact. We create a patch with the correct elevation, and we patch this patch into the original dam. This is the workflow that I suggest. It's not the only solution, but it is a solution. What you could also do is you mask out the artifact, set the artifact here to no data, and interpolate the no data, which is in this case a little bit of an overkill, because the interpolated value will be constant. So no need to do any funky spline or whatever interpolation. You can simply set everything to the same elevation value. Nearly possible, but not exactly. So if I zoom to this thing, I'm still catching stuff that is here, zero values that are within the computational region, but outside the artifact. So I cannot simply say everything that's zero must be replaced with 27 because of the shoreline of the lake. Okay. So I really tried to give an outline of the workflow to remove this artifact in non-GRASS language. So like in generic language to describe how it would be, how it could be done. So I hope this is understandable for everybody without knowing, or anybody without knowing anything about GRASS-specific stuff. Maybe someone would call the clumps, not clumps, but clusters or patches, but I guess the principle is, I hope the principle is understandable. Now the question is, if you want to follow me through the actual exercise, or if I should just explain how this could be done. We have queried the map with the this query tool here. Simply here, query, activate this and click somewhere and find out the raster value at this location. The next step would be to extract the elevation of the artifact, so to get all the patches that are at this particular elevation of 0 meters. Again, my preferred r.mapcalc module, which I like very much. The command would be something like this. Now we have an if statement. In other words, we would set this masked new map to 1 if the level, see if the elevation is 0, and otherwise we set it to 0. 0 means no data. So the question is if I should demonstrate this, or if you want also to follow me through with this example, because it's already past 5, so it's up to you.
Yeah, you decide, but be careful, you have to still make it to the restaurant.
Then I would suggest that I walk through it, I show you how to do.
One more thing, on Friday, I put a glass block.
Okay, the first thing I do here is I set the computational region to the whole map. Standard procedure. I could, for the purpose of identifying this patch, shrink the computational region to that this thing is just covered, but because this is not a lot of data, grid cells, it's not really worth the effort. For speed reasons, I will cut and paste the commands from the presentation onto the command line. So this is exactly what I showed here, the map calculator expression, set 0 elevation to 1 and everything else to no data. Doesn't recognize these. So now we have the zero areas, and everything else is no data, just to illustrate. No data, in if I query the map again, they are indicated by the star. So the star means I don't know what is there, it's no data. The next step would be to figure out the correct elevation, query the map. We have established that. This is minus 27 meter, which is everything around this funny patch. Then we create clumps with unique IDs. The command, grass command here is called r.clump. I'm adding this result to the display. Now I can see that every patch got its unique ID, and all I want is to have the ID of this artifact here. So I query the map again, and I get the ID of 2099. I use the map calculator again to create a patch. So if the ID is 2099, set the new correct elevation to minus 27, otherwise to no data. Sorry. Oh, okay, this one worked. Let's have a look. So now I have created this patch There's only one value in there, minus 27, which I can see by looking at the metadata. So the minimum is minus 27, maximum also minus 27. And the last step in the workflow is to patch the two together. Here the order is important. I patch the cast, the original DEM, with this patch that I created. That means first it looks at this raster map and then at this master raster map. If it finds a valid value in here, it uses this one, otherwise that one. You could do exactly the same also with the map calculator. Okay, finished. Done. So that was.
Do you have an idea why I get an error in one of the earlier steps to make the extraction? So map calculator, it gives an error, invalid map, GMPED Caspian.
I have put at Caspian, but that's this was the original one, but the tool gives the same.
There is. I have an idea. Okay. So yes. This gave you the error, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, try to insert.
At Caspian already, I did.
White space. I'm not sure if this. GMTED Caspian. Hey. G. Dot. List. Okay. So it's this is the name of the raster map. Not this one.
I renamed it here.
That's only for display purposes, so you have to use this name. Okay. Okay. So the workflow in general made sense to you. This is was an illustration on how to use the map calculator and how to identify clumps or patches by their unique ID, and then I would actually create a patch to fix that original DEM, which was in this case not an artifact created there, but it was simply missing tiles. And yeah, they're missing tiles. So for real ocean, it makes sense to replace missing tiles with zero, but not in these cases. Yeah. So that was it. So this was the end of this part, and we are now also at the end of the whole exercise. Okay. Thank you. It took me longer than expected, so I could not show you the grass-R interaction. But I guess that I think the grass-R interaction is not very complicated. It's really very easy to use with the SPGrass6 package. And if you're interested in it, I can, of course, give you on Friday a quick demonstration on how to use grass and R together. Otherwise, you're, of course, welcome to come up with any other questions. On Friday, if you have particular problems or want to know if this or that can be done.
Well, so we will collect first the votes by people. So, also back in, and you will get the vote.
Uh-huh. Well, anyway, I will be around. You can also come in the coffee break to me. And
I cannot guarantee that there will be a vote.
Yeah.
Most likely we will do the Friday, we will all be in the same room.
Ah, okay. Yes, I will put it online later on. By tomorrow morning you will have it, okay?
Is it not already online?
I think not, because I discovered some typos and mismatches here and there.